Okay, first, let's start with what is a parable? The point is to grab your attention and take you from the known to the unknown. What the parable does is it brings you into the story to where you can relate to what Jesus is saying. And Jesus knew that by telling the story, it will engage you more. It'll get you to think more. It'll get you to critique something. It'll get you to respond to something. It'll make you more aware, so that if you're willing to see the analogy in what he's talking about, it'll clarify things up and make sense to you. And then it leads you to decide, well, if you want to further your understanding with Jesus Christ, but most of all, your relationship with him. And Jesus knew that stories help to break down and explain the sides, the details of what he was talking about. Or the parable will get you to, it'll trigger you to want to further your education about something. But most of all, the parable is speaking to the people who want to hear. They have a true desire to hear what Jesus is talking about. For those who have open ears to hear, there's meaning to the parable. But to those who are biased and who really don't truly seek and desire to hear from Jesus, they won't understand. So when Jesus is speaking about the parable, he's speaking to two types of people with two mindsets. One is closed-minded and biased, and the other is open to hearing how Jesus breaks it down by using the analogy in the story of the parable. So if we go to 2 Timothy 3:7, listen to this. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Some scientists would be biased towards this book, because science says, show me and I'll believe. But faith says, God says, believe, then I'll show you. You see the difference? There's a person who reads this with the closed mind, who is in opposition and who is in resistance towards God, and who shuns the things of God because he doesn't open up to want to even hear from God. So that person will blindly open this book. That person will blindly feed themselves and interpret this in a wrong way, the way they want to interpret it. But to the person who is open to wanting to understand this book, that person will receive it, because he's believing, he's acting out of faith, and then God will show him what the parable means. So when we go to Acts 28:27, this is where Paul is talking to the chief of the Jews, okay? Pharisees, scribes. This is what he's telling them. For the heart of these people is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes have they closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. So Paul's telling us there are people who are dull of hearing. Look at that real close. Dull of hearing. That's by choice. Keep that in mind. That is by choice when you read this book and when you hear from the word of God. Now, what is the seed? Luke 8:11. Now, the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. 13:10. And the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? Why do you speak to them in parables, Jesus? That's what they want to know. This is what Jesus said. He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. Right here, Jesus is saying, to some people, they already get it, but to some others, they don't get it. So Jesus tells the stories with an analogy. He puts it in parallel in order for you to get it, and so that you can make an informed decision when you're hearing the word of God. Come up to 13:12. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away, even that he hath. Therefore speak I to them in parables. That's why I speak to them in parables. Because they seeing, see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing they shall hear, and shall not understand. And seeing, ye shall see, and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing. Dull of hearing. And their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should be converted. Right there, key word right there. And should be converted. And I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Okay, let's start right there. There are some people who clearly understand the kingdom of God. They clearly understand the death, burial, resurrection, and why Jesus came and died on the cross for our sins. But there are others who don't understand. But Jesus gives them the chance, gives them the option to make an informed decision on whether or not they want to listen and pay attention and take heed what's in this book, or when they hear preaching at their church, or even if you're not, or even if you don't go to church, you still have the option. God always gives you the ability to hear it and understand it. But if you refuse to and you reject it, whose fault is that? That's your fault. That's why Jesus wants you to know here that he gives you the free will, the option to make an informed decision each time you hear. And guess what? Every person in this world will hear this book. They will hear of Jesus Christ. They will hear that Jesus saves. They will hear that you must repent. You must change your ways. You must get out of sin. You must stop sinning. You must stop committing idolatry. You must stop playing with sin. You must get out of that lifestyle. You will hear that. Let's go to Luke. In Luke 8, this is where Jesus breaks down the parable that he just spoke about. And he's explaining it here in detail. Okay, you got the seed, the sower, and the soil. In Luke 8:11, the seed is this. Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Okay, we know the seed is the word of God now. Who is the sower? The sower is the person planting the seed in the soil. You represent the soil. The seed represents what? The seed represents the word of God. Okay, you guys get it? You with me? So now, Jesus is talking to the people again. And when much people were gathered together, and will come to him out of every city, he spake by parables. Luke 8:5, this is where he begins. A sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. The wayside, what is the wayside? The wayside is the edge of the road. It's the edge of the garden. It's the edge where there's no real place to plant the seeds. So they stay above ground and they get stepped on, trodden on. The fowls of the air come and devour it. The foul, when you hear fouls, you think of the devil. You think of the enemy coming in to take and snatch those seeds before they get a chance to grow and uproot into your life. So if we go down here to Luke 8:12, this is how Jesus breaks it down even further. Those by the wayside are they that hear. I got that circled for a reason. We'll come back to that. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. So what happened with the first seed? You really didn't take it serious. You didn't really get it ingrained in your head. It didn't edify you. It didn't build you up. You didn't take it serious. The seed was planted to you. Somebody told you about the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you were like, okay, I believe in God. Yeah, man, I'm serious about this. Yeah, all right. So somebody gives you a little Bible study or whatever, you know, maybe for a couple weeks. I don't know. Maybe a couple years. Who knows? But this person's heart is not really dedicated to serving the Lord. So when the seeds get planted in this person's life, the person is unable to maintain their relationship with God because they never truly or fully got committed to live for Christ. So at first they wanted to be with God, but this person is a person who just acknowledges that God exists and that he does believe, like most people do. When you come across people out there and you start telling them about Jesus, everybody's a Christian. Pretty much everybody claims, yeah, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins. Yeah, I believe he's the savior of the world. But this person, sometimes they don't repent. Sometimes they're not sincere about their walk. And this person is definitely not devoted to staying and walking in Christ. So this first person by the wayside receives the word, never takes it serious. So as soon as the devil comes, all the devil has to do is this. Just flick this person, and they're off course already. This is a person who never really wanted to change. They thought about it, but you never, ever really came to the knowledge and the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ because you wanted the world. You wanted to stay in the world. You wanted to live in the flesh. You didn't want to let go of the things of the world. But here's the sad part. You see that word right there? Those by the wayside are they that hear. So this person heard the word, right? Just like all of you. You heard the word of God. You see it everywhere. You can't get away from it. God's going to make sure that you know that he is the one who is probing you. It may irritate you, it may upset you, and it's going to offend you sometimes. But I'm telling you this, every single one of these people represented in this parable, the four people, the one that fell by the wayside, the one that fell by the rock, the stony places, the one that fell by the thorns, and the one that fell on good ground, they all heard the word of God. Each and every one of them heard it. So that means that you have a chance before you stand before the Lord. You are going to have no excuse. As to why you did not come to the Lord. You're going to have no excuse as to why you rejected the word of God. So, very important, that word here. You're going to see it again in the next one. Watch this. Number two. This is the second seed. And some fell upon a rock, stony ground. And as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. So now let's go down and see what Jesus says about falling on the rocks. Luke 8:13, they on the rock, who's that? That's everybody. On the rock that fell on stony ground are they which, When they hear, there it is again. When they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root. Right there, no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. So the second seed in this parable is talking about those that fell upon the stony rocks. Now the breakdown. They on the rock are they which when they hear, they receive the word. Okay, at first they receive the word of God with joy. They're excited. They get saved. They're on fire. That's what happened to me. They're on fire. And they're telling everybody, yeah, man, I just got saved. I'm going to change my life now. I'm done with that. I don't want to live like that no more. I'm out of darkness now, man. I'm done. But these have no root, which for a while, believe, and in time of temptations fall away. So at first, they're rolling strong, right? You're in Christ. You come home. You're telling everybody. You're excited. And when you tell people, they're like, what the heck? This is Jesus, you got saved? What? What's up with that? What about us? I thought we was cool, man. We ain't going to party no more? You ain't going to go to the club with me no more? What, you done sinning? Oh, you better than me now? You know, you're going to get people like that, man. Or you Mr. Self-Righteous now? Are you too good to drink now? Are you too good to smoke weed with us now? Are you Mr. Goody Two-Shoes now? You know, you're going to get that. But not only that, see, the devil's still going to test you. Say you got excited, right? And you started hanging around people who knew the word of God, and you started going to Bible studies or whatever, and you attended church, but you never really got rooted into the word of God. You were riding on the tailcoat of other people pretty much. And they were like pulling you along with this walk with God, in Christ. So since they had to pull you along and you never really established any deep roots with God, this is what happens. And you was cool, like it says, for a while. And you were believing, you were excited. But what happens? And in time of temptation, fall away. Let me tell you this, this temptation is coming. If you're a new believer, it is coming. Believe me. And who is that? Who's going to do that? The devil's going to come for you. Straight up. He's coming for your crown. He's coming to extinguish the light that you just got from Christ. He's coming to put it out. How is he going to do that? He's going to come with your favorite sin you used to walk in. He's going to come with that old girlfriend. You know, she might come back and say, hey, you know what? You know, I really miss you. You know, I miss what we used to have. Here's another way. He's going to come with, like, if you used to drink or smoke or pop pills or whatever, he's going to come with some free liquor, some free weed, free cigarettes, whatever. He's bringing it to you. Yeah, people are going to come over, invite you over. Hey, man, I got your favorite this and that. I got this and that. I got blah, blah, blah. Something is coming your way to try to keep that seed that God has planted for you, for your growth. The temptation is coming to try to take away that seed that was planted, that was meant for your growth in God, in Christ. But something, some kind of temptation is going to come to take it away from you, to take it out of your heart. That way you can't and won't be edified, and you won't grow in Christ. Now the third seed, and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And the breakdown, and that which fell among thorns are they which when they have heard, there we go again, you heard it, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. So with this person, the seeds fell in the thorns. Right, there's that word again. They heard it. Go forth and are choked. Choked with what? That's suppressed, shut down. Satan will shut you up. That's his job. With cares, distractions, hindrances, more temptations, things that sway you away. Could be every wind and wave of false doctrine. Could be New Age. This person hasn't got established in the Word still. This person is distracted too by riches and pleasures of this life. So this person is focused on the world. The Bible says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So whatever's going on in this person's life, they're plagued with the issues of life. The concern with trying to get money, the concern with the get rich prosperity gospel, concern with gurus and teachings of yoga and spiritualism. It's something that's not right with God because it produces no fruit. But they think that they're good with God, that they're walking right with God, but they're not. Their perception in view of the Word of God has been choked. And in some cases, they have strayed away from the faith, which is apostasy. Because when you don't know the Word of God, and say like somebody comes to your church and your pastor allows them to speak and they have a New Age spirit on them and they tell you that it's okay to practice transcendental meditation as a Christian. It's okay to dabble in or with Christian Science. It's okay with Christians to co-mingle the gospel with the Muslim faith, with Mormonism, with Catholicism. You're getting thrown off right here because you're getting choked up because you're not versed in the Bible, because you're not studying the Bible. You might even pick up a book outside of the Bible that teaches you the Bible, but that book is a book of false doctrine, which is swaying you away. See, this person can also be a false convert. See, a false convert will not produce any fruit for the Lord. They'll produce fruit, but it'll be the wrong fruit. And they may be even walking in deception. This is a very important parable right here. And you must take this serious because if you're not rooted in this Bible correctly, you are going to fall into apostasy. You are going to drift away and Satan is going to snatch you up and he's going to devour you. So Jesus is telling you, what's going to happen? He's giving you a warning in this parable so that you can know, okay, what to expect. Like when I first got saved, I never read this. I read the Bible, but I didn't read it as much as I should have read it. So which one was I? Right here. I fell upon the rocks, the stony rocks. Let's read that again. They on the rock are they which when they hear, receive the word with joy. That was me. I was excited, man. I was on fire for Christ. I got baptized. I started going off. I came home, told everybody, man, I just got baptized, man. I'm good now. I'm done drinking. I'm done partying with you and everybody else. I was so excited. So then I started learning about God. You know, and I was rolling strong for a little while, man. I was good. But I didn't have no root. I didn't stay committed to God. I had some Bible studies. I went to discipleship with a couple people. But I never established deep roots in this Bible. But then what happened? I stopped going to church. Me and Pops used to battle right here. Yep. As soon as I got saved. 95, 98. I got baptized. Came over here. Talking to my dad, everybody else was here. We went to war immediately. You know, he wasn't trying to hear it. But let me tell you, my dad got saved before he died. He died in 2010, but he got saved. He repented and he got baptized. Praise God Almighty. But when I got saved, he was like, because we used to party together. That's my pops right there. Hard head, man. Hard head, stubborn. Straight, tell you like it is. That's how he was. So we went to war, man. And I never thought about it, but I guess I was planting seeds at the same time. You know, because nobody else was telling them about Jesus. But so I popped up on the scene. I'm like, yeah, I found this Jesus. I found Jesus. Jesus found me. But then what happened? Temptation came, boy, and I lost it. Mm-hmm. I fell out of the church. I fell off, drifted away from God. And guess what happened? The devil snatched me up. Yep. I went right back to my old ways. New Year's Eve party. Everybody's offering me drinks. I'm like, no, no, no. Rejecting it. No, everybody's getting tilted back. Tequila, everything was there. Finally, here comes that last cup. Here you go, I made it for you. I'm like, oh, all right, I'll just have one. Boom. That was 2001. I fell back from 2001 to 2013. I got handled from 2001 to 2013. The devil smashed on me. So what happened? It was this. I opened the door wide open. I left that door wide open for the devil. Yep. Me. I did it. Pride, selfishness, self-will, inequity. Don't play with temptation, boy. I'm telling you. Started smoking again, drinking again. Boy, oh boy. Got into a fight right away. Immediately, things started going wrong. Instantaneously. So right after I took that drink, very next day, I was at the liquor store. Mm-hmm. Old English, 40 ounce, Newports. A couple days after that, hooked up with an old homie. We went to another homie's, broke down. I was like, man. And they knew I got saved too. Mm-hmm. Man. Broke down. I was like, man, you know what? Let's go get a case, man. They was like, what? I was like, man, I don't want to hear that, man. Let's just go get a case. They was like, I thought you quit, man. You're living for the Lord now, man. But what about the Lord? You're living for the Lord now. I'm like, man, don't ask me no questions, man. Let's just go get some brew, man. And they was like, all right. Then on, everything went like that. Everything. Watch out for the temptation, all right? Watch out. This is for those of you who are thinking about going back or who already are back to the old lifestyle. This is for you right here. This is why things got worse for you. This is why it's going to get worse for you also. To those who are on the fence, to those who are debating on whether or not they should go back to the old lifestyle. That's what I did, man. I'm telling you, it's no good. Don't do it. Don't play with it. Don't play with the devil. Do not play with the devil's devices. Do not test God. I'm urging you. Please, do not take that temptation lightly. Whatever it is, don't play with the devil. He will take you out. Before you know it, you're going to be like, what the heck happened? What the heck happened to everything I used to have? What the heck happened to me? What happened is you opened the door for the devil to come in. You gave him consent. And now he has legal authority. And now he has legal ground in your life. Don't let the devil fool you, man. Please. I urge you. Please. That's why I stay in Christ, man, because I don't want to go back to that. If I go back, I know I'm dead. With my hard-headedness and my stubbornness, if I go back to that lifestyle, it's not going to be good for me. It's not. In Luke 8, this is the last seed here. And other fell on good ground and sprang up and bear fruit an hundredfold. That's the good seed right there. And when he had said these things, he cried, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." So this last seed in the parable, Jesus breaks it down here. "But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard," they heard it too, right there. There you go. All four of them heard it. "Having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience." And that there is the parable of the seed sower. All right? Very important. This person made a decision right here. After he heard the word of God, he made that decision. He made the willful decision to be honest and to have a good heart and to no longer walk in his old ways and to fight the good fight of faith and to daily call on the Lord. That's how God wants us to be. And Jesus gives the examples right here with the parable. This is a powerful parable. You know, I wish I would have learned this when I first came to the Lord, but I didn't learn this part. But it's not anybody's fault. It's my fault. I should have gotten deeper in the Bible and I should have thoroughly researched it. So now I'm telling you guys, go through this book. Seek the word of God diligently. And don't stop. Don't ever stop, because the enemy is always going to tempt you. The enemy is always going to come with something to try to rob you and try to keep that seed from keeping you from growing strong in the Lord. I'm telling you, you open that door up, you let that devil in, you play with that devil, you're going to be a casualty of war. Matthew 12:43. "When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man," okay, I got cleaned up, got baptized, was happy, filled with joy. I was happy because I got the evil out, because I was happy because Jesus freed me up. And I was excited to be freed from the bondage of the sins that I was living in. So when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through the dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. That's the spirit right there. You think this is a joke? You better wake up and recognize there are demonic entities that are out to destroy you. 44, "Then he saith, I will return into my house." That's the old vessel, the old body that he came out of, "from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept and garnished." So now, what does that mean? That means when that unclean spirit is rebuked out of you and you are walking with God and everything is all good, and then you stray away like I did, as soon as you stray away and you start dabbling or playing around, you stop talking to God, you stop praying, he comes back. Because he's been assigned to you, okay? They say there is a demon or two or three or more assigned to us. We don't know exactly how many, but there are some that are assigned to you. So it wants to come back. And if it finds out that you no longer have the Spirit of God with you, protecting you, abiding in you, and your soul with no protection and garnished, then goeth he, that spirit, and taketh with himself seven other spirits. Here's the scary part. More wicked than himself. More wicked than the first spirit that was assigned to you, destroying you already. Now it goes and gets more. Seven other spirits that are more wicked than itself. And they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. Right there.
So when I open that door up a little bit, little by little, like that, the devils came rushing in, straight up. And I got worse, than before.
With the hangout, with the homies, I was back doing the same old thing. Back to my old ways, cursing and everything. But I was worse this time. I got into a fight weeks after I started drinking. Like, almost like 2 or 3 weeks after. I was at the park with 3 homies. And one of the dudes I knew had another homie there. He just got out of jail. And he was wolfing, boy. And I was already like on edge all the time because I was irritated at that time. I was already mad and upset. So this cat starts wolfing. He's like, yeah, I'm an OG, homie. I just met the dude. I'm an OG. We're all drinking, you know, doing our thing. Got my truck bumping music, drinking more liquor again. Then this cat that my homeboy brought starts running his mouth. He starts wolfing about, yeah, man, I just got out of jail. I'm an OG. I'm a gangster. This and that, blah, blah, blah. I'm a gangster, homeboy. I did this. I did that. I did this, blah, blah, blah. And I'm just sitting there. I'm like, man, dude, getting on my nerves, man. So I pull my other homeboy off to the side. I'm like, you know what, man? I'm about to whoop this mother effers, blah, blah, blah. That's exactly what I said. Because I was already in it. Then he was like, well, do what you got to do, homie. So I walk back over. I'm like, you know what, homeboy? Put that beer down, man. I said, you a gangster, man? You hardcore? But see, I wasn't a gangbanger. I was a fighter. Keep that in mind. But I knew a lot of gangbangers. Bloods, Crips, Cholos, Asian gangs. So I called him out. I'm like, what's up, man? What's up? So you just got out of jail. So you think you all hard? Then what's up? Let's get down, man. Let's get down right now. Just to provoke him, I slapped him real hard. Then that got him going. So we ended up fighting. I laid him out on the ground. He's all busted up. And he's real heated now. So he gets up and he pulls his knife out. And I'm like, all right, I run to my truck. I go get my bat, because I have a bat in there all the time. And I got it, and I'm holding it. I'm like, man, you swing that knife, I'ma crack your dome, homeboy. I'ma crack your dome right now. So he puts the knife down and he's like, all right, I'll be back. I'ma go home and get my 9 and I'ma shoot you. So I was like, hey, party's over. Time to go. So he takes off, and then I tell the homies, let's go, man. I ain't trying to get shot. So I take off. But anyways, the point is this. I invited all that back again, all that mess, all that drama, all that chaos. I was so clouded with the cares of the world, with the temptation. The enemy pulled me out because I grabbed his hand and said, okay, I'll take a bite. I bit the hook and Satan pulled it up, reeled me right in, and I got handled from 2001 to 2013. That's why 2013 is the year, man, where I rededicated my life to Christ. I gave my life fully to Christ and I started studying more. And I haven't stopped since then. Now I stay entrenched in the Word. Because I want to be entrenched in the Word. I love the Lord, man. I love Him with all my heart. I don't want to go back anymore. I'm not going to take any more chances, man. And I highly urge you not to take any chances. And don't let temptation in, all right? I'm giving you examples of my own life, okay? I'm using my own examples. Some of these stories I've never even told. And I got so many, man, that I'm going to tell you guys. And the reason why I'm doing that is because I love you guys, man. You know, and I care about your soul. You know, the enemy beat me down. Took everything I had, man. Now I know how to fight. And since I know how to fight, I'm showing you guys and I'm trying to plant seeds. I'm trying to sow seeds into your life. So that you know what to do when you get hit with the same things I got hit with. Go deeper with the Lord. Take it to the next level with the Lord by studying to show thyself approved and by rightly dividing this word. Go deeper with the Lord. Make your roots go deep. Dig a deep foundation and keep your roots firmly planted. That way, when you spring up, you can draw the proper nutrients from God through your roots. And that's what keeps you stable in life. That's what keeps you from falling in life. Yes, things are going to come to try to shake you and rock you and throw you off course, but you go deeper with God and you get back into the roots. You stick to the principles in the book. You study God's statutes. You read the Old Testament on the way he was with people. You read how he longs to have a relationship with you. You study the wisdoms of Proverbs and Psalms. You study the four Gospels of Jesus Christ, talking about Jesus' life. Study hard, okay? Don't stop. The seeds have been planted in your life, and some of you are not taking it serious. Some of you don't think that Jesus Christ is going to leave you behind. Some of you are playing games. You're walking in apostasy. You're making stuff up. You're watching all this stuff on the internet versus reading your Bible, saying there is no such thing as a catching up of the church. It's right here. So if you're not firmly established and rooted in Christ, you're in serious trouble. You are in serious trouble. Acts 2:38. Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Start asking the Lord, how do I get my roots deeper with you, Lord? How do I go deeper and stay firmly planted in you? I don't want to be like the first three seeds, Lord. Guide me, Lord. Instruct me. Give me wisdom and understanding. That's what you should be asking. Get yourself away from the deceptive practice that you're involved with. Whatever it is. Some of you don't think Jesus Christ is going to leave you behind. Some of you don't believe in the judgment. Some of you don't even believe in hell. The seeds have been planted in your life. You can shun hell off all you want. You can say it's not real. You can say the judgment is not real all you want. That doesn't change anything. It just changes your perception. And that's what the parable represents also. A false perception about how you should be walking with Christ. You got a lot of false converts out here, man. People who don't even know the word of God. You got to recognize that the devil comes in a suit and he'll fool you and get you to think that you're all good. That devil in the suit is some pastors running these mega churches with fog machines, big screens, laser beams, and skinny jeans. Watch out for these false teachers out here, man. This ain't no joke. Take the word of God serious and know that Jesus loves you and does not want you to perish and die in sin. Let the seeds that have been planted in you sprout by studying the word of God and through heavy prayer every single day. In Jesus' mighty, precious, holy name. Amen, amen, and amen. Remember when I told you that girl told me that I needed Jesus? She planted a seed. Years ago, many other people sowed seeds into me too. Now I'm telling you, you need Jesus. I'm sowing seed into your life now. You need Jesus.